Mobile games represent the largest segment of the gaming market, and that space is tremendously competitive as a result. We've heard from our community that they want to know more about how to succeed on mobile platforms. So, this is part one of a series on the basics of mobile games, how they acquire users, and how they make money. We are Ask Gamedev, and this is Mobile Game Development Explained. Welcome back. We make videos on how to elevate your game development and inspire others. If after watching this video you want to continue the game dev conversation, check the video description for a link to our Discord server. Traditionally, console and desktop games have been monetized through premium pricing. You spend a set amount to receive the full game experience. In the early days of mobile handheld gaming, the premium pricing approach continued on platforms like the Game Boy or PlayStation Portable. With the global adoption of smartphones, we saw a lot of changes to the gaming landscape. This included the mainstream move to freemium game experiences, where consumers could access mobile games for free, with in-app ads and purchases acting as the most common routes to user monetization. As expected, this change in user monetization has had a ripple effect on how mobile games get developed. Historically, games were released for PC or console on disc or cartridge, and that meant developers essentially finished developing the game before shipping. For the most part, they had no intent to touch the build again. Customers were monetized one time only and typically at the point of initial sale. Mobile games changed that approach, and development teams have embraced the live ops structure that has become popular in many areas of software development. This involves shipping an efficiently developed but viable product with the intent to iterate and improve the experience based on live consumer data that shows where the game is succeeding and failing. These live improvements aren't just focused on gameplay, but increasingly on the game economy and monetization strategy. In detail, the live ops lifecycle is similar to traditional development in that a pre-production period kicks things off, with a focus on exploration and proving of gameplay assumptions around making an experience that is fun. This is followed by a production period, where the team creates the launch features, monetization and analytics framework, and live event infrastructure to allow for updates to the software after release. After an internal bug fixing and tuning period, mobile games typically release in a limited territories list, or a soft launch. This way, they can get live crash data and address major issues in the build before going to a worldwide release and a larger audience. This is also a good time to gauge base level retention and conversion metrics. Once in full launch, most freemium mobile games drive monetization through live events, which are scheduled periods where special gameplay or rewards are offered to users for a limited time frame. Offers and promotions to boost monetization or re-engage players are commonplace during these periods. It's popular for developers to focus live events on major holidays or themes, like Christmas, Easter, or Halloween. Live events are typically the primary point of monetization for mobile games, so they are a huge part of the release strategy. They often coincide with user acquisition campaigns and introduction of new features or content. Live events are also important as they typically provide great user data and can inform user acquisition budgets. As with any game, a mobile title has a finite lifespan. Metrics will show when core users start to increasingly depart the game for other experiences, and developers typically combat this reality by developing similar or complementary titles to sell into their existing user base. This allows the developer to continue to monetize the users beyond that first piece of software. For more information on the live ops cycle, PlayFab has a great overview of it that we recommend and will link to in the description. Now, let's talk about mobile games monetization in detail. There are three models that have been the most popular: IAP, IAA, and paid apps. In-app purchases, or IAP, is the monetization model of choice for a huge portion of mobile game developers. Only 4% of gamers actually make in-app purchases, but those paying customers are the core focus of freemium developers. IAP typically includes three different categories of purchasable items. Firstly, consumables. These are purchases that are made, then consumed within the app, such as extra lives, additional moves, or in-game currency. users typically purchase consumables to further their progress through a game. A user can also buy non-consumables, sometimes called entitlements, which are often used to unlock access to features or content within the game. Think of additional customization options for your characters that are often cosmetic in nature and don't normally enhance game progress. The final type of IAP is subscriptions, which is probably more typical in general applications as opposed to games. Apps will often use subscriptions to upgrade users to a higher tier of functionality after initial use. The subscription model is most beneficial for the minority of apps that consistently provide ongoing value to loyal users via regularly updated features or content. IAP and monetizing your audience is a deep topic that we will cover in depth in part 2 of this series, so check that out if you want to learn more. In-app advertising, or IAA, is probably the most popular form of monetization for indie game developers. It's easy to set up and doesn't typically require development or a complex economy structure within your game. You simply integrate with an existing ad platform that will serve ads in your game, and you receive payments if your users engage with those ads. If you have a lot of users, this can be a worthwhile strategy. Rewarded video, in particular, has proven itself as a legitimate business model in the game economy. If you want to integrate ads in your game, there are lots of ad networks available. Popular ad solutions include MoPub, AdColony, AdMob, and AdSense. Again, check out part 2 of this series where we will dive deeper into IAA and strategies for optimizing your ad revenue within your mobile games. We've talked a lot about freemium monetization, but there are lots of games that make money on mobile through the old-school premium model. People pay once up front for the full game experience. Many console or PC games that port to mobile follow this approach. If you check the top paid apps charts on iOS and Android, you will often see a lot of familiar names from traditional gaming platforms. The paid app approach means less development time around live events and, in comparison to a freemium title, has less post-launch support requirements. How do mobile games get users? Well, there are two methods. They either pay for them via advertising in other apps, or they gain them organically. Organically is always preferred, as the users are gained for no cost. These are typically users who heard of your game via word of mouth or other media. Paid users are acquired by placing in-app advertising in other apps. Social media sites like Instagram and Facebook are popular ad spend destinations, but you can also use ad networks like AdMob. The best choice really depends on the audience you're trying to attract to your game and where they already exist. Users are commonly bought on the basis of how qualified they are. On one side of the spectrum are very unqualified eyeballs, and you pay for them on a cost per impression basis. This means that the ad network simply guarantees that the users will be shown your ad and nothing beyond that. The quality of these users is typically low, and you will often only see a small portion convert to users of your game. That said, this can be a cost-effective way to get acquisition data and can help provide your game with an initial user base. As you become more confident in your retention and monetization metrics, you may look to increase the qualifications of your user acquisition spend by looking towards cost per click, cost per install, or cost per action campaigns. You will only be paying for users that perform certain actions with these approaches, but keep in mind that you will pay much more for that certainty. The typical user acquisition strategy of a mobile developer is to efficiently test and analyze their various ad campaigns so that they can be more certain of their key metrics before making large ad spends. If you can determine that the lifetime value of a user in a specific cohort is greater than the cost to acquire that user, you are well on your way to user acquisition success. ROAS, or Return on Advertising Spend, is a good metric to track with these efforts. ROAS measures gross revenue generated for every dollar spent on advertising and gauges the effectiveness of online advertising campaigns. ROAS is equal to the revenue from ad campaigns divided by the cost of an ad campaign. Developers typically A/B test all of the different variables in a campaign. target audience, characteristics, ad copy, target platform, etc., in effort to continually optimize ROAS. Developers will also regularly adjust their in-game economies based on the user data they see once users are in the game. You'll want an analytics solution to make sure your ROAS is on point. We recommend Kochava amongst the various third-party options. If you know anything about mobile game or app development, you know that there are a lot of acronyms around the popular metrics used to evaluate performance. We're going to quickly go through some key things to track. So, how many people are playing your game? That is measured via your daily active users metric, DAU, or monthly active users metric, MAU. How you define active is up to you, but it usually involves booting up your game. ARPDAU is up next. It stands for Average Revenue Per Daily Active User. This will help you understand the revenue potential of an active user and will inform your user acquisition strategy and what you can pay to gain a new user. Retention indicates how good your game is at bringing people back to play it. Specifically, this metric shows the number of unique users who came back to your game at future points after first opening the app. The most commonly cited points are Day 1, or D1, Day 7, or D7, and D30. Some people track D3, or D28, or D90. It's all specific to your game and what the typical life cycle of a user is. The key point is that you should know your drop-off percentages so that you can see where you can optimize your gameplay and extend user retention. The users that keep coming back are usually the ones who are most likely to monetize. Any modern user analytics solution should provide the aforementioned metrics. If you developed in the Unity engine, we have found that the Unity Analytics package is easy to integrate and pretty comprehensive. If you have developed in other engines, Flurry is a popular option. We've also found that Crashlytics is a good option for additional user insights, specifically around crashes, session data, and overall user behavior. Another respected option is PlayFab, as it provides user management analytics in addition to excellent data on back-end performance. If you want to make your own iOS or Android game, check out this video on the best game engines for making mobile games.